All right. Well, it is good to be back here in the house of the Lord tonight. We're going to continue on a series of messages tonight that we started 2 Wednesday nights ago. How to deal with how you feel. Because we are certainly emotional people. And as we've already explained, there's many different types of emotions that we as human beings experience. And some of the emotions that we are experiencing are helpful and good emotions, but there's some emotions that really and truly are not good for us. And so how do we handle these situations? We look at fear the first Wednesday night that we started in this series, and the Bible clearly tells us how that we can deal with a fear or any type of fear that may come against us. Then last week we looked at depression, and depression is a very serious matter in this day and time, and so many people suffer from different levels of depression. But people in the Bible, they also suffer from depression. People in the Bible also suffer from fear. Most of the emotions that we experience in our everyday life, somebody in the Bible, many people usually, have experienced these things, but you can also read and see not only what may have caused these feelings of emotion, but you can also see how that God was able to help people that were overcome by some of these different types of emotion. And there's lots of emotions, and we're going to continue to look at these over the next several Wednesday nights especially. But tonight is a very special emotion that probably everybody here at some time or another has felt. And maybe some people here tonight are dealing with it as well. And I wonder tonight, have you ever heard the expression that guilt is written all over your face? Have you ever heard that expression? That sure is. You look as guilty as sin, don't you? Well, tonight we're going to be dealing with guilt because I know I have experienced it many times. And what causes you to feel guilt? Well, I think it's because you get caught a lot of times, don't you think? I don't think I would have felt guilty if I'd have got by getting cookies out of the jar if I would have never got caught. You know what I mean? It didn't really bother me eating the cookies at the time or so forth like that. But when I was standing there before my dad, he was asking me about it. And you know, he somehow could know. I mean, he could know that I was guilty. And so I believe our Heavenly Father, no doubt about it, he knows that we are guilty. And there's some emotions that goes on when you feel guilty, isn't there? And we want to discuss some of those tonight. But I want you to think, and if you can remember how it feels to be guilty of something or another, and you've been found out somehow or another, and so forth like that, and how you felt about that, how do you think we're going to feel when we stand before God? Yeah, I want you to remember what it feels like to feel guilty. And I want you to escalate that 10,000 times concerning what you're going to feel like when you stand before God. So if you will, please, tonight, look in your Bible in the book of Psalms, chapter 32. We're going to start out in the book of Psalms, chapter 32. We're going to begin reading verse number 1 through verse number 5. I'll give you a few moments to find your places there in the precious Word of God. All right, on the boards as well. So if you will, please stand with me now. Those that are able, as I read from the precious Word of God. Listen to these wonderful encouraging words to start with. But then you're going to see how that David changes in a way, and he remembers what it was once like before he got things made right with God. Now look at verse number 1. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no God. When I kept silent, my bones waxed cold through my roaring all the day long. For day and night my hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into a drought of summer to autumn. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquity have I not healed. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgivest the iniquity of my sin. Now, Heavenly Father, I am so thankful that you are a merciful God. For, Heavenly Father, I know in my own case there are many times that, dear God, I rely upon your forgiveness of my sins, dear Heavenly Father. Lord, I know that there's been many times I've been guilty of this thing, that thing, or another. Lord, I know what it means, and I know what it feels like, dear God, is this psalmist of David is writing here in this passage of Scripture. It feels so good, dear God, to get it out, to confess it, and to get forgiveness. But Lord, until we do that sometimes, it really bothers us, and it just keeps us from being able to find rest or peace in our lives. So Lord, I'm thankful for your mercy and your grace. But help us tonight to learn how to deal with how we feel concerning guilty. For these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. You may be seated tonight. Now, I wonder if we've already opened the discussion earlier tonight concerning guilt itself. Have you ever in your experience been able to tell that somebody is guilty of something just by the way they look? Have you ever been able to do that? Especially with children, right? I know now why my dad know I got in the cookie jar. Because I've had two children and I've got a grandson now. And I know what it looks like when somebody feels guilty about something. But you want to know something? Really and truly, we all have had that look on our faces probably many different times for many different reasons. Now, have you ever felt guilty about something? Just raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Okay? Some of you have never been guilty, but here, you know how it feels, okay? How does it feel? I want you to remember, how does it feel to be guilty? How would you express that to somebody? How would you express what it feels like to be guilty of something? Does it cause you at times to be scared? Well, I know when my dad really started looking at me, and really I could tell it seems like he knew that I was the one. And so for what? But I tell you, I started to get scared. Have you ever been scared because he's guilty of doing something? Because there's consequences sometimes for us doing things, aren't there? Okay? What about shame? Have you ever felt ashamed when you're guilty of something? Certainly you have. You know better. You know you should have done it. But you feel ashamed. Have you ever been nervous? I think that's a big giveaway sometimes. When somebody's confronting us, you know, because there's some type of expression on our face that literally shines out. But I tell sometimes people get nervous when they're guilty of doing something. How about trouble? Does it trouble you when you are guilty about something? Does it bother you, in other words? It bothers me sometimes. Does it hurt you? Does it hurt you when you've been found out? It hurt me later times after my dad found out, but it hurt me sometimes. You know, the fact, you know, I know better. I should have done that, but I've done it. I thought I could get by with it, but I did. You know, so it does hurt sometimes. It really does. And so we need to anxiety. You know, I think sometimes it causes anxiety to come on people when they're guilty of something, but they want to confess it. They just keep trying to cover it up or ignore it or deny it. The things I'm here to tell you now, it is a terrible feeling sometimes. And when I look at this passage of Scripture in chapter 32, I believe with all my heart that David knew what it was like to feel guilty. And it's a very serious emotion that we all have probably experienced many times over in life. And we're probably going to experience it some more as our life goes on. So I know what it feels like to feel guilty. I've been on that guilt trip myself many times. How many of you have taken that journey? I've been on a guilt trip many times in my own life. So how will we feel when we stand before an almighty God who knows everything about us, and we're standing there without any excuse whatsoever, and he begins to question us this, that, or another? I believe that all the guilt that we felt here on earth is going to be escalated into even greater depth when we stand before a holy God and he tries to show us this, that, and another that he knows. That he knows that we are guilty of and we've not been willing to confess it and to come before God and ask for forgiveness for it. Here's what have you been guilty of? Maybe it was something you said. Have you ever been caught up with something? I started with someone who and they said, "Boy, I hate gossiper. I do too." You know what? But you know what happens all the time to a gossiper? It catches up with them. It really does. And there's times when you can just see it written all over their face when you're standing around talking and you just repeat something that you know that they said. But they don't want you to know they said it. Uh-huh. But you know the guilt. There's something you said sometimes and it gets around and it comes back on you. I've said things like that. I'm not a perfect human being. I've said things that I wish I wouldn't have said. Anybody else in that boat? Yeah. Now, I've said some things I wish I'd have never said. Amen. And I'll tell you what, it'll get around to you. So that is some of the things that causes people to feel guilty. It's what you say. Sometimes it's what you did. And more so of what I did than what I said. I'm guilty of saying things I shouldn't have said, but I am rarely guilty of doing things I shouldn't have done. And I'm telling you right now that there's some times I have felt tremendous guilt about getting that cookie jar. I really have. Anybody ever did anything like that when y'all was young? Really getting a cookie jar? Have you ever noticed how that ceramic dish and that lid sends off an astonishing alarm if you just barely touch it once you know it? I mean, I'd be extra careful trying to really lay this little lid back down on there. It's worse than a fire alarm going off in the house. You've got to get caught up with it, all right? You've got to break them something. Have you ever been guilty of breaking something? Yeah, I've done that. I broke things I wish I wouldn't have broke. I stole something. You feel guilty because you stole something? What about if you hurt somebody? Have you ever been guilty for hurting somebody? Maybe you hurt them physically. Or maybe you hurt them mentally. Have you ever felt guilty about that? Or when you treated somebody at some point in your life? Have you ever felt guilty of lying? You said something, you told a lie, and it come back on you. Have you ever felt guilty about lying? Have you ever felt guilty about somewhere you went? You know you shouldn't have went, but you went anyway. Have you ever felt guilty about that? Sure you have. Have you ever felt guilty about watching something that you shouldn't have watched or looked at something that you shouldn't have looked at? Have you ever felt guilty about that? Sure, those are some things that cause us to feel guilty. Have you ever felt guilty for not being faithful to God? Think about that. Have you ever felt guilty for not being faithful to God? Have you ever felt guilty not being faithful to your spouse? Have you ever felt guilty for breaking a promise? Have you ever felt guilty about that? Have you ever felt guilty about you didn't spend as much time with your children as you should have spent with your children? Well, I feel guilty about that. I really do. What about spending time with your spouse? Do you feel guilty about not spending as much time with your spouse as you should have spent with your spouse? Yeah. What about feeling guilty about should have helped somebody more? What about feeling guilty about you didn't pay your taxes? Yeah. Well, you ever felt guilty about not paying your tithe? You should. You should have felt guilty about that. What about doing your homework? You ever felt guilty about not doing your homework? Yeah. How about you, have you ever felt guilty about not leaving a tip on the table? Anyway, when we look at this, we need to learn then how to deal with how we feel, because we're going to be really facing times of guilt many times over in our lives. And especially here in the book of Psalms, chapter number 32, we find out that David here is bothered by guilt. And we find out that David here tells us in verse 3 and verse number 4, it says, "When I kept silence, my bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long, for day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into drought of summer." David knows what it was to feel guilty. And David here is telling us and trying to put it into words how it felt for him to feel guilty. It was affecting him day and night. It was affecting him physically. And it certainly affected him emotionally. David here is guilty of something, and it was really bothering him. So what was it that you think of that could have been causing David to feel so guilty? What do you think it was that caused David to feel so guilty? We can find the answer to that because it goes along, chapter 32, the book of Psalms, it goes along directly with Psalms chapter 51. And in the book of Psalms chapter 51, I read in verse number 3 there, but in Psalms chapter 51 and verse number 3, the Bible is saying that David is confessing, he said, "My sin is ever before me." It wasn't that was making David feel guilty. It was because he knew he had sinned. And of course, we can go on and we can study what in the world would have caused David to feel so bad. It was because of some sin that had transpired in his life, and his sin was always constantly bothering him. Does sin bother you? When you sin in some way or another, it should bother us.
Because if we sin, if you're saved, you've got the Holy Spirit of God putting conviction upon our lives. And that conviction is not going to be satisfied until we know how to deal with how we feel when it comes to feeling guilty. Here in this passage of Scripture, we realize that David here is feeling guilty, and it's bothering him day and night, and it's causing him to have physical reactions to it. And the thing that was really causing him to feel guilty was the fact that he knew he was a sinner. Let's look at his sin. What kind of sin do you think this particular case was speaking of? Don't you know it's a bad sin? I know that sin is sin, the small sins are just as bad as the big sins, but here I'm telling you, this is a big sin. What kind of big sin was it that David had not confessed? What kind of big sin was keeping David awake day and night? What kind of sin was causing David to not be able to physically function right and find any kind of peace at all? It was a hideous sin. It was a bad sin. It was a horrible sin. David had an affair with another man's wife. It bothered David. Thank God it did. And thank God that when we sin, it does bother us. Because friends, if it don't bother us, we've got to check that to see whether or not we're safe. David was having an affair with another man's wife, and her name was Bathsheba. I meant to look at what her name means. Bathsheba. But I didn't. I might go home and do that anyway. But David, instead of confessing his sin, this is one of the most key things that can help you handle guilt in your life. And it's called confession. Confess your faults. Confess your sin. David here tried to cover it up, though, didn't he? Wouldn't it have been so much better if David, when he had committed this sin, wouldn't it have been better if he had went ahead and confessed it and said, I made a mistake, oh God, please forgive me, and so forth and so on? Wouldn't it have been better on David's part? It certainly would have been better. He tried to cover it up when he found out that Bathsheba was pregnant. He ordered Bathsheba's husband to come back from the battlefield. And he thought that Bathsheba, Uriah was his name, would go home and spend time with his wife, and so possibly that the pregnancy could have been associated with Uriah instead of being blamed on that affair that Bathsheba and David had together. Now he's trying to cover this up. I don't know about you, but very seldom have I ever been able to get by with trying to cover up sin. The Bible clearly tells us that if we're children of God, that's what happens. Your sin's going to find you out. And friends, it's a whole lot better to go ahead and confess your sin from the get-go than to wait until it winds up in the newspaper. On channel 8, 9, 10, whatever. Because sooner or later, your sin's going to find you out. All right? But David tried to clear up his sin. Now he called for Uriah to come back from the battlefield. He was hoping Uriah would go home. He wouldn't have no more problems. But here comes Uriah here. He went home. He went to the town. Instead of going home and seeing his wife, and there might be a message in that, you know. He should have went home and he said something, hey, or something to him. Yeah, I thought he should have. I know, when you go, when you see your wife, you don't get upset if your husband had come home from war and he didn't come speak to you or see you or anything like that. He wanted to see the president. That really made me mad. But anyway, instead of going home, he slept outside the door of the palace. I didn't come home by getting drunk, he'll go home. I'm telling you, when you start trying to cover up sin, it just keeps escalating. Can you see here how this is escalating? And how much simpler and better it would have been if David would have just said, I'm sorry. I repent and be sincere about it, of course. You don't just say it, you really mean it. But look at his sin. I'm telling you, it's a horrible sin. David had an affair with another man's wife, and it was Bathsheba. And he tried to cover it up, and he tried to cover it up. But it means that finally come to the point that the only way David felt like he was able, will be able to cover up this sin was he was just going to have Uriah killed. Now, this is David, who the Bible says is a man after God's own heart. This is David who wrote the 23rd Psalm. This is David who defeated Goliath. Jonathan. This is David, who had been a great warrior for God. Now he has gotten so entangled in this sinful action, instead of confessing it, he gets deeper and deeper and deeper into it, and sends a letter to Uriah's commander. And the letter to Uriah's commander was, make sure that Uriah is put in a battle situation where there is no possibility of him surviving. And so his commander sends him into a battle situation, and Uriah is killed in that battle situation. Then when we look back into this passage of Scripture, we find out in verse number, chapter number 32 that I've just read to you, he will admit he has not said anything about his sin to anybody. And I want to tell you something. You might think you're getting by with it. And you might think that, well, nobody else knows about it. Or you might think nobody else is going to care about it. But look at what David says there. This is what's troubling him. Look at verse number 3 in chapter 32 again. When I kept silent. When I kept silent. My bones waxed old through my roaring all the day long, for day and night. My hand was heavy upon me. David had not gotten by with it. He had not covered up his tracks sufficiently. And it was costing him because he was under conviction and he knew that he was guilty. When I look into this passage of Scripture here and I see how that it was affecting David, I can see how that it affects us the same way a lot of times. And can I say this as sincerely as I know how? Being silent about your sin to God never lets the guilt go away. Have you ever found that out? Being silent to God about our sin never causes the guilt to go away. All day long he was restless. All night long he was sleepless. We see this is the effect that guilt can cause somebody. When I look back in chapter 32 and verse number 5 again, I see in verse number 5 of chapter 32 it says, I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and my iniquity have I not hid. I said, I confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sins. Boy, for over a year David would do this. How long has it been that you might be carrying guilt in your life for something or another? I mean, for anything. Maybe you hurt somebody's feelings. Maybe you've said something that you shouldn't have said out of place. Maybe whatever the cause is, whatever it is that you might be guilty of, how long have you been carrying around? David had been wrestling with this for some time, about a year. David had been dealing with it. And it finally got to the place that he was really to come before God there in verse number 5, and he was willing to confess, and he said, I will hide my sin. Basically, I'm not going to hide it any longer. You know, if you feel guilty tonight, the best way for you to handle that guilt, that way you feel, is for you to come and confess it before God tonight. And really, come and confess it before God tonight. For David hid it for that long a period of time, and it really took a toll on him. What you need to do, like David says there, I acknowledge my sin unto thee. Now, David knows that God already knew all about it. But David here had to come and he had to confess his sins, and so do you, and so do I. For over a year, David had went through all this situation. And I want to tell you right now that the only way and the greatest solution that you can ever find is by coming to God and confessing your sins before you. So what does David do to handle that, handle his feelings? He went ahead and he went and admitted his sins. You admit your sin. He says, I confess my transgressions unto the Lord there in verse number 5. And there in that verse, the Bible is saying there, the word confess literally means to agree with. To agree with who? When you say, I'm confessing my sins, you are confessing your sins to God. You are agreeing with God about what he says about that sin and what expectations you have to take care of that sin. In other words, when you come before God, you're under conviction. You know that you are guilty. When you come before God, you acknowledge to God that you know that you have sinned and this is what you've done. And when you're saying that to God, you're going to agree with God that this has been wrong. And I should have done it. That's what confession is.
Your agreeing with God is what God says about that particular sin. Maybe you lied. You say, God, I'm sorry I lied. I know that I should have done it. It was wrong, God. I wish I hadn't done it. God, I said something that I wish I wouldn't have said, but God, I said it. I'm sorry. God, please forgive me of my sin. That's what that means, to come and confess your sins before God. Because God, I'm telling you right now, not only does God want us to confess our sins, but God wants us to forsake our sins. I mean, really, too, there's a lot of people that maybe sometimes come to an altar somewhere and they say, God, I know I'm a sinner. Well, that's not really confession. God already knows you're a sinner. God knows I'm a sinner. So you're just, you need to come to the altar and say, God, I know that I'm a sinner. And God, I know that it's wrong. And God, please help me not to be like this anymore. That's repentance. If you're willing to turn from your sins and not be like that anymore. And that will help you to how to deal with how you feel. So we look at that, and we can see here that really the book of Proverbs, chapter 28, verse number 13, clearly says. In Proverbs 28, verse number 13, the Bible says, he that covereth his sin shall not prosper. Now, if we haven't learned that lesson, then something's wrong somewhere. You need to learn that lesson. You can't cover your sins and prosper. You're not going to get by with it. He that covers his sins shall not prosper, but whosoever confesses and forsaketh, then shall have mercy. That's pretty clear. How to handle what's ideal with how you feel with it. How to confess it and forsake it. Okay? That's what God is wanting us to do here, and that's what David was willing to do eventually. It just took him a long time to do it. So when David goes around and he confesses his sins, he admits his sins, then we're going to see how and what happens when you confess and repent of your sins, you become blessed. Why would you want to walk around miserable? Why do you want to walk around feeling guilty? And you know you are guilty. We're all guilty at times. Why don't you come ahead and be somebody that is blessed by God? Look right now in verse number 1 of chapter 32. In verse number 1 of chapter 32, look at, blessed is he whose transgressions is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Well, I thank God, thank the Lord, when I've confessed my sins and repented of my sins, that I know what it feels like to be forgiven. Isn't it wonderful? To know that your sins have been washed away. To know that your sins are not going to be brought up before you. Again, isn't it good to know? Like, blessed is he whose transgressions is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Now, we know what the word blessed means, don't you? What do you mean, church? That's right. I'm happy that my sins have been forgiven. Don't you? I'm glad I'm not carrying that guilt trip around. I'm glad it's not written on my face that I've done something wrong. I'm glad I can realize that my sins have been forgiven. I'm a happy person when I let that transpire. The Bible goes on and tells there in chapter number 32, verse 7, thou art my hiding place, thou shalt preserve me from trouble, thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. Does this make a lot being in fellowship with God? But you're not going to be in fellowship with God if you're guilty of some sin or not. You need to be willing to come and confess those sins before God. And let God forgive you of your sins and let God take you. Isn't it wonderful like that? I like it like that. I'll tell you what, God can put a shout in our lips, a song in our heart, ain't it? When we go before the Lord and say, Lord, please forgive us of our sins. And not only do I see how that a person can be blessed when they're willing to confess, I'm here to tell you what, it's a wonderful thing to realize that God forgave his sins. And God has forgiven my sins so many times. So then the Bible there says, in verse 1, chapter 32, blessed is he whose transgressions, of course transgressions are sin, blessed is he whose transgression is what? Forgiven. Forgiven. Does that mean God's going to keep bringing them up? Does that mean you have to keep coming back every day and say, God, please forgive me of this again, please forgive me of this again? Not that you have never repented of it. And I've never been sincere about it. But John says, when God says, I will forgive it, the word forgiven there literally means to lift, to carry, to bear, to lift up, to carry away. So I confess my sins before the Lord, he takes them away. I feel like I get excited about that. Man, it's wonderful to have that blessing of forgiveness. But not only does God forgive us, I'm going to tell you right now, God
forgot all about his sin after that point. I'm really glad about that. I'm really thankful that God forgives us about that. But I'm going to look at verse 21 again. Chapter 13. Blessed is he whose transgressions is forgiven. God says, I'll carry him away. Whose sin is covered. Now, something's covered, can you see it? Now, what does the word cover there literally mean? The word cover literally means conceal. God has covered him up. And he can't look at it, see it, no more. I like it what the Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse number 34. In that passage of scripture, the Bible says, the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. You want to learn how to deal with how you feel? You want to get rid of guilt? You need to confess your sins before God. You need to be willing to forsake your sins before God. And you get ready for a blessing from God, because God is going to forgive you, and God's going to cover that sin. And the Bible says, I will remember their sin no more. Isn't that wonderful? Oh, thank God. Praise his precious name. The Bible says in the book of Psalms 103, verse number 12, as far as the east is from the west, so far hath he removed our sins from us. That's when you confess your sins. That's when you're willing to repent of your sins, to confess your sins. God removes our sins. Isn't that wonderful? And I like what David goes on to say in chapter 32, verse number 2. He says in verse number 2, chapter 32, blessed is the man to whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no doubt. The word imputeth, that really means to charge to somebody's account. In other words, when we ask God to forgive us, he wipes that debt clean. He doesn't charge it to our account. Now, isn't that good? You think about it. All the things we've done, if we sincerely come and confess our sins before God, he is faithful to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and he doesn't hold it over our head anymore. That's wonderful, isn't it? I love it. That's wonderful. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord imputeth not iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no doubt. Well, I'm thankful to God, aren't you, for his mercy and his grace. It's wonderful. It's great. It's powerful. Alright, so this is how you deal with guilt. You need to realize that you are guilty before God, and you need to go ahead and confess your sins and forsake that sin. Now, I know this, that I have done that before. I have confessed it, and I believe God has forgiven me of it, but there's been still sometimes I feel guilty. Has anybody else ever experienced that? I keep sometimes thinking about it. I wonder why, Lord, you done forgive me of it. You done moved it away as far as the east is from the west. You dropped it in the deepest part of the ocean. You said you're not never going to bring it up before me ever again. But God, I'm still bothered by that particular sin. Why am I still bothered by that particular sin? Well, I want you to know that there's two people or two beings that will convict us of our sins or keep bringing our sins up. One is the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit, the Bible says in John 16 and verse number 8, the Bible says, when he has come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. The word reprove there literally means convict. He will convict us, the Holy Spirit. Okay? But guess who else is always trying to accuse us of being sinners? Satan. Does he not go before God day and night accusing the brethren? And they continue to argue with us and all these different things like that? But friends, I'm here to tell you right now that we need to realize that the Holy Spirit is the one who convicts us of unconfessed sins. Now get this. The Holy Spirit only convicts us of unconfessed sins. The devil keeps accusing us of sins that we have already confessed before God. Because God ain't going to pay no attention. God ain't going to deal with it no more. It's already been dealt with. It's already been covered. It's already been paid for. It's already the slate has already been marked clear. There's no retribution for it. The devil's going to keep bringing it up before you. Every time you think you want to do something for the Lord, the devil's going to say, well, don't you remember when? Don't you know how you were? And all of that. And that's the devil. If you confess your sins, then it's all been forgiven. And it's the devil who's bringing those sins up before you. Well, I love that. When I got to thinking about that, how that God has forgiven me of my sins and so forth, and I realized that, you know what? That devil, he keeps trying to bring those sins up before me and keep trying to show me how sorry I am and low down I am and all this, that, and other. But you know what? I am unworthy. There ain't no doubt about that. But I'm glad that God forgives me of my sins. And when I have done wrong, it is so good, the sooner the better, to go before God and confess those sins so that you don't have to keep wrestling and be guilty and feel bad about it and so forth and so on like that. Let's stand up, Pete. Now at this time, as they come bring the song of invitation, how are you going to deal with guilt? Well, we've all been guilty of something or another. We've all done something somewhere along the line that we wish we wouldn't have done, or we wish we wouldn't have got caught for one, or something like that. We've all been guilty. What do you do about it? Well, you want to wrestle with it? You want to be miserable day and night? You want to affect you emotionally, spiritually, and you want to affect you physically? Or do you want to finally succumb and give in and come before God and confess it? Sometimes you may need to go to somebody else and say, you know what, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I've done that. And you know what the Bible tells us? If somebody comes before us and they're sincere about it and ask for our forgiveness, what should we do as Christians? We should forgive them. And what type of forgiveness should we have toward somebody that may have done us wrong? The same kind of forgiveness that God has toward us. If I say I forgive you, then we should not never bring it back up again. It should be separated from us and never be anything between us ever again. It would cause us to feel guilty one way or another, or bad for one. Because that's the way God is. When I say, God, I'm sorry. God, I repent. God, I don't want to be like this no more. God says, good, see. As I'm washing this away and covering it up, I'm not going to bring it up no more. But you know from experience, the old devil, but you rest assured, it ain't coming from me. And it won't never come from me. Heavenly Father, we bow our heads tonight, we are thankful for your mercy and your grace. We're thankful, dear God, that when we know that we are guilty, whatever it might be, that God, if we'll just come before you sincerely, and with a repentant heart, and ask you to forgive us, as we confess, that you are faithful and just, and you will cleanse us from all sin. Lord, help us, dear Father, not to go around with all these different types of emotional effects because of guilt in our mind, but in some guidance in Jesus' name. Don't forget about the children. They're going to be going to play putt-putt this Saturday, and also this coming Sunday night, right after the service, have an ice cream social. So we're certainly looking forward to that. We're also looking forward to all the Sunday services as well, and Sunday school. We're just excited about all that God is doing. Let's be dismissed. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for your word, because once again, it's been a light into our path and shown us, dear Father, how to deal with this.